Shalom, and welcome to Via Havta Yisrael, a Hebrew phrase which means, you shall love Israel. We hope you'll stay with us for the next 30 minutes as our teacher, Dr. Baruch, shares his expository teaching from the Bible. Dr. Baruch is the senior lecturer at the Zera Avraham Institute based in Israel. Although all courses are taught in Hebrew at the Institute, Dr. Baruch is pleased to share this weekly address in English. To find out more about our work in Israel, please visit us on the web at loveisrael.org. That's one word, loveisrael.org. Now, here's Baruch with today's lesson.
Well, today I want to give you some practical information. Information that is going to teach you biblical truth about the attitude that you should have as believers and things that we should do, not only for other people, but here's the biblical truth. That when we do these things to others, it is going to have a spiritual impact in us. Meaning, when we behave in this way, it is an invitation for the Holy Spirit, for Him to go to work in our life, bringing about change, godly transformation in our lives. And hopefully that is enough motivation for you to stay tuned and take out your Bible and follow along with me. Because it's not what I say that's so important, but what the Word of God reveals. We need to see that this is inspired truth. The Holy Spirit created this book. And in the same way, the Holy Spirit, the first time we see the Spirit of God mentioned in the Scripture, it is to bring order. And here's the truth. This book, one of the reasons that it was given to us, is to bring order, godly order, into your life. But the question that you have to answer is this: do you want that type of order? Do you want to be a person that lives in a way that is pleasing to God? Do you have faith in doing so, that there will be a great reward in His kingdom? See, if you really don't believe in the kingdom of God, if you don't have faith in prophetic truth, what's going to happen in the end and for eternity? If that's not something that is foundational in your heart, then you are going to be easily moved away from where God wants you to be. And little by little, your life is going to go back, if you were a believer, it is going to go back to how you lived. And you're going to experience frustration, emptiness, and you're going to be an individual that is downcast, not knowing the joy, not knowing the power, not knowing the promises of God. See, I don't want that for my life. And my hope is that you don't want it for yours. Well, take out your Bible and look with me to the epistle to the Colossians, Colossians chapter 3. Now, we began this verse last week, but we ran out of time. And I want to pick up where we left off, reviewing a few minutes about what Paul is speaking to believers here. And once again, he speaks in the terms of commandments, not suggestions, not advice, not counsel that you can listen to and then make a decision whether you want to obey it or not. No, this is truth that you need, and I want to emphasize that, you must apply to your life. And I make you a promise. If you do so, you are going to be glad that you did. I mean, these things are not trying to get you to do something that someone wants you to do for their sake. No, when we do these things, although we will be pleasing to God, we will be participating with His will, doing His purposes, realize the one who benefits the most eternally will be you. So it's not doing so because we want to get you to do what, well, naturally you wouldn't want to do. No, if you had perfect knowledge, if you could see things from the perspective of eternity, if you could look back on all that your life was, having done so, lived it out, and been in the kingdom of God and looking back, you would have desperately desired to know this and put it into action into your life. Well, let's begin. Colossians chapter 3, verse 12. Now, he's been using for a couple verses language, which really means to dress yourself, to put on. And once more, it's in a commandment. Now, why does he say put on, dress yourself? Well, if you're a good student of the Bible, you'll know something. You'll know that clothes are frequently spoken of symbolically as good deeds, as living a fruitful life, good deeds. So he says here, verse 12, therefore, and that's a word that appears over and over. Based upon what he's revealed, therefore you should do this. Based upon what he's taught, what he's commanded, therefore you should behave in a particular way. And that's what he's saying here. Therefore, clothe yourself. How? Well, when a person gets dressed, they usually do so based upon where they're going and what they're doing. They want to be appropriately dressed. Well, same thing for us spiritually, because ultimately, this is what the Word of God reveals. We're on a journey, and we are pursuing the living God. And as we submit, as we obey, as we do the scriptural counsel, we are drawing near to God, approaching Him. And therefore it says, clothe yourselves, therefore, as the elect, and that word speaks about choice, having been chosen by God. So the elect of God, you belong to Him. He has chosen you. Therefore, you need to present yourself in a particular way. For you are, notice what he says, you are holy ones, that's the term saints, also beloved. Now think about that. God looks at you because you're in a covenant relationship with Him through Messiah Yeshua, through the gospel. And He says to you, you are a saint in my eyes. You are holy to me. Here again, not because of what we have done or haven't done. It's all because of the sufficiency of the work of Messiah. He says, not only are you a holy one to me, but he says, and I love this, he says, also beloved. Now, it's in the plural because he's talking to a congregation of individuals. So holy ones, beloved ones, and then he says something. He uses a phrase, we mentioned it last week, that it speaks about bowels, and it's talking about the pit of your stomach. It is a center of emotional feeling. Oftentimes when we're nervous, oftentimes when we're excited, sometimes when we have nostalgia, having feelings that are brought up, remembering the past, sometimes in love, when we see that person we love go by, it touches us in the stomach. And this is that same location, but it's not about love, it's not about nostalgia, it is about, what's the next phrase? Mercy. And I mentioned to you last week, very briefly as we were closing, that many times when we look at the gospel, Messiah sees an individual that has a great need. And because he sees this need, the scripture says, he is moved with compassion. And that's how we should be. Why? His character should be our character. His spirit is now living, dwelling in us, and hopefully ruling you. And because of that, his feelings should be our feelings. So we should be moved with compassion. And then he uses a word, and this word has to do with grace. It's probably better translated as kindness. And what it speaks about is this. It speaks about behaving in a way to someone else in order that the will of God they will receive. It is a word of ministry that is motivated by the grace that you've received, knowing how precious it is, how powerful it is, how it changes your life. You want, because v'ahavta lerecha kamocha, because you love your neighbor as yourself, you're going to want them to have that same experience. So it's behaving in a way, investing in another individual for the will of God, it might be realized in their life. Then it says, being mindful, how? Being humble-minded, or thinking humbly. Now, all of this, when we look at this passage, we're dealing with ministry, we're dealing with service. And when you think about, from an Old Testament perspective, who was the servant of God? Well, in the Torah, we see that one of the ways, my favorite way, by the way, that Moses is spoken of is as the servant of God. And the Word of God also tells us that he was the most humble. So when he says, look at the middle of verse 12, when he says, be humble-minded, think in humility, it is a necessity. It's a necessity in order to serve God. When a person is full of pride, they can't serve God. So be humble-minded, be meek. And meek has to do with patience. It has to do with waiting for God to provide rather than you go and just taking it yourself. That's why it says the meek, they will inherit the earth, meaning these kingdom blessings, God's creation. We're going to get all, but we don't take it. We're meek. The meek inherit, that is, that we wait patiently for God to provide what He wants us to have. So we're supposed to be meek, and then notice the end of verse 12 where he says, and long-suffering. Now, I would take out a highlighter and highlight that. Underline it. Write it down. This term, long-suffering. Now, last week, I joked with you that if we had a conference understanding the wrath of God, I don't think many people would sign up for it. It wouldn't fill a stadium. And likewise, notice what it says. Now, the context is important because if you go back to verse 12, who's he addressing? The elect of God. Now, sometimes, for example, in Matthew 24, when Yeshua speaks about the elect, he's speaking about Israel. He's speaking about Jewish people who are lost, but he's going to gather up in the last days for the purpose of salvation. But usually when Paul speaks about the elect, he's not so much speaking about an ethnic group, a particular one, but he's talking about those Jews, those Gentiles who are in Messiah through the gospel. So this is who he's addressing and has been addressing throughout this epistle. And he says, look again, as the elect of God, he says, clothe yourselves, dress yourself with all these things. And verse 12 ends with the phrase long-suffering. I wonder how many people would come to a seminar, a conference, some study, if the subject was learning how to suffer long periods of time. But when we look at the Word of God, that's our call. When we walk in obedience, when we're doing what God has called us to do, we are going to suffer for long periods of time. Now, I wonder how many people realize when they said yes to the gospel, how many people have walked down that aisle to receive the good news for the purpose of salvation. How many realize what they were saying yes to is this? God's there saying, who will suffer long for my purposes? In obedience to me, who's willing to suffer for great periods of time? I wonder how many people would walk that aisle, raise their hand, say yes. But that's what we've enlisted in as the elect of God. And it goes on, look at verse 13. All of these are behaviors, actions, mindsets, and behavior that is appropriate as believers in Messiah Yeshua. He says, bear the burden for one another and forgiving each other. So bear the burden. It goes along with suffering long. We're supposed to put up with things, bear things for one another. And also forgiving each other. And if a certain one, doesn't matter who it is, he uses that Greek word tis for anyone. If a certain one should have something, some complaint. What does he say? Just as also Messiah has forgiven you, thus also you. Meaning this. If you have a complaint, meaning someone is complaining against you, what are you to do? Bear that burden. Forgive them. Or if you have something against them, forgive. Meaning this, and it's a two-way street. Don't be upset. Don't get angry because someone has a complaint against you. Deal with it. Go to them. Love them. Suffer long. Bear that burden. Heal that relationship. And likewise, if you have something against someone, what does he say? And this is the best context for understanding what he's writing here. He says, forgive one another. Just as also Messiah has forgiven you, thus also you. Forgive completely, fully, no matter what it is. Why do that? Look at verse 14. Because there's something that is foundational for a believer. And what is that? The law of God. Now, probably many people would be hearing this and thinking, why are you bringing the law of God, the Torah, the commandments? Because the law of God teaches me. See, you know what does not come natural to me? Love. You know what comes natural to me? Selfishness, pride, putting myself above all things. That's natural. But that's not how a believer should behave. No, we need to walk in love. He says frequently, love one another. And therefore, because love doesn't come natural, we have a whole bunch of commandments. Now, when I speak about commandments, I'm speaking first and foremost about these law, these commandments of the Torah. And you say, well, what does that have to do with what he's talking about here? Notice what he says in verse 14. He says, above all, do what? Above all of these, love. For love is a bound or a bind of perfection. So when we demonstrate love, it keeps that binding of people together for the perfect of perfection. What's he talking about perfection? The will of God. Here's the message. We should be so interested in the will of God, the purposes of God, that we don't want anything to affect our relationships with others. Why? Because if I'm going to be part of God's will being done, it usually just doesn't involve me. See, the reason why Messiah speaks about the congregation of the redeemed, the ecclesia, the church, as the body of Messiah is because the body has many members, many parts. So if God's work is going to be done, we need to learn to work together. And therefore, we need to keep that bond of peace, that bond that leads to perfection, the will of God. And therefore, for that to be a reality, I need to demonstrate love. And when I look at the law of God, it's all about love. When we look at the two commandments that speak, that define, that characterize all those 613 commandments, what do we find? V'ahavta et Hashem Elohecha bekol levavcha uvekol nafshecha uvekol meodecha, which means love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, umodecha, with all your very essence. And that's why sometimes it's spoken about as strength. And then he says, v'ahavta lareka kamocha, love your neighbor as yourself. So when we characterize the commandments of God, they're all about love. Loving God and loving your neighbor. And it's because I love God and have experienced His love that now I can love my neighbor. And in doing so, I can be long-suffering. I can bear those burdens. I can forgive. And if I have anything against someone, I can forgive them just like Messiah forgave me. What's the cause of it? Look again at verse 14. But above all things, love, which is this love, which is a bond of perfection. verse 15. Now, Paul's coming to an end of this section that really begins in verse 1. We've been in it for several weeks. But the section is chapter 3, verses 1 through 17. And now we are in verse 15. And notice what he says. And the love of God, let it rule. Now this word, you know, if I was going to translate it literally, it has contained in it the concept of an umpire. Now, umpire watches things, and based upon his knowledge of the game, he makes decisions. He sets things in order. And what it's saying here is love does that. When I am operating in love, it will act as an umpire. It will set things in order. So the rule, and I'm talking about God's rule in a situation, can be manifested. So look again. He says, and the peace of God, let it rule in your heart, for which you have been called into one body. So we see the connection between operating in love, applying the truth of God, the word of God, the instruction of God to my life. And when I do so, what's the outcome? Well, what does he say? He mentions verse 15, and the peace of God. It's only when we do all of these things we've been studying for the last 3 weeks that we're going to experience the peace of God. And realize this. The peace of God is connected to the will of God. And when the will of God is being manifested, when it's being worked for, when it's completed, what happens in leading up to it and after the fact, there is going to be a manifestation of, and I like this, power. There's a connection between the will of God and the manifestation of the power of God. So if you want the power of God in your life, be concerned about the will of God. Move on to verse 15, the second part. And he says, do all of this with what? Thanksgiving. Now, let me tell you that thanksgiving is one of the most important feelings that we can have, and we need to offer it up consistently to God. Being thankful, showing Him gratitude for why. God, you have put me in this position. You have a purpose for me. I am being called to minister, to do your work. I am your representative. What a wonderful experience. What a terrific calling. Therefore, he says here, with all this, he says, also do, it's a commandment, with thanksgiving, verse 16. And the word of Messiah, let it dwell in you richly, the word. Now, this word has to do with purpose, but also the scripture. Because through the scripture, we learn the purpose of God. So notice what he says, look again at verse 16. And the word of Messiah, let it dwell in you richly in all wisdom. Meaning this, you put the word of God in you, you're going to have wisdom. And what is this wisdom? It reveals how to make use of the knowledge of God. So have the word of Messiah, let it dwell in you richly in all wisdom, for it teaches and admonishes one another. And in doing so, what does it do? It leads us into worship. He says in verse 16, the second part, and psalms and hymns and spiritual songs in grace, singing in your heart to the Lord. Now, notice, we've seen so many times Messiah, Messiah, Messiah. Here, a change. He speaks about the Lord. And this is so important because the context is worship. And Messiah, he ministers into our life. And when we experience the fulfillment, remember we've talked about peace. When we see the fulfillment of the things of God, what is it going to bring about? A desire to worship Him. And just instinctive, naturally, we're going to break out into worship. And that's why it says here, through psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, in grace, singing in your heart to the Lord. And all which you do in word or in deed, all things in the name of the Lord Yeshua, giving thanks to God and Father through him. Now, notice something that is so special in this passage. He says here, whatever you do, all things that you do, whether it's in speech, word, or whether it's in deed, do all these things, what did he say? In the name of the Lord Yeshua. Now, this is important. What's important? This word, name. Because name is synonymous with character. I realize I say that often, but it's such an important truth. Because that word, name, appears frequently. And what he's saying is this. If we're going to be successful servants of God, if we're going to worship him, then everything we do must be in his character. Meaning we must become more and more and more like him. It's exactly how John the Baptist. Now, we know that the scripture says of those born of women, meaning in a natural way, no one is greater than John. And I believe one of the reasons that that's true is because John understood something. And what was that? When he says, I must become less and he must become more. And what's he talking about? Who I am has to be hidden. It has to disappear because I need to live as him. That's what he means, that he must become less and Messiah in his life must become more. And that's what this scripture's talking about here when it speaks about us operating, living, behaving in the name of Lord Yeshua, that is, in his character. And that's why one of the ways that you can grow spiritually is always attempting, praying, seeking God's assistance to demonstrate his character in whatever situation you're in. It's when you're living in his character that his power is going to be revealed, his wisdom is going to be provided, his knowledge is going to be extended to you so that you can act as he would act. And when you do so, great things will be done and worship will come about naturally. Well, I'm out of time. Until next week, may God bless you.
Well, we hope you will benefit from today's message and share it with others. Please plan to join us each week at this time and on this channel for our broadcast of loveisrael.org. Again, to find out more about us, please visit our website, loveisrael.org. There you will find articles and numerous other lectures by Baruch. These teachings are in video form. You may download them or watch them in streaming video. Until next week, may the Lord bless you in our Messiah Yeshua, that is, Jesus, as you walk with him. Shalom from Israel.